My name is Dr. Stanley Maphosa. I work for the Academy of Science of South Africa. I'm also a steering committee member of the Science in Exile and the TWAS regional coordinator for Sub-Saharan Africa. Colleagues, this initiative on science exile started in 2017 following a workshop that was hosted by TWAS and some partners that include the Euro Medical University and the Italian National Institute of Oceanography. The whole year of 2018, the initiative built up its momentum through a number of interventions like workshops, working group, consultation, and finally an application was made to SIDA, who then funded this initiative, which was then launched in March 2021 this year. We're currently sitting at a space where there is already a board in place, a steering committee in place, task teams, as well as the secretariat that comes from the three organizations, TWAS, International Science Council, and IAP, that are helping us to host this meeting today. And also, there have been a number of webinars. This is number two of the webinars, of the four webinars. There'll be two others that are coming to just begin to discuss this issue, ensure that we create a network of like-minded organizations so that we can campaign and be able to support the displaced scientists as well as those that are at risk, so that they are also integrated in the host countries where they find themselves in, because science is quite critical for us as Science in Exile to be able to see that those that are in the science space are gainfully represented, despite the fact that they may be exiled, they may be at risk, they may be displaced, but science is quite critical for humanity. And we have been, you know, honored in this meeting today that we have distinguished speakers that are going to speak and engage us. And I would like to encourage you to participate fully, and in future, invite others to come and participate in some of these other discussions that we are going to have through the Science in Exile webinar series. And with those words, I would like to officially open this meeting and say, let's stay on, let's discuss, and let's enjoy the discussions. Over to you, Peter.
Okay, thank you very much, Stanley. Perhaps if we can move back to the slides very quickly. As Stanley said, this is the second in a series of webinars. The first one focused on immediate crises, if you like, such as what is happening in Myanmar and what is sort of accelerated a little bit in Ethiopia, the Tigray region of Ethiopia, especially over the last few months. This second webinar, as the title says, we're looking at protracted crises. And you'll see here just a figure, you'll see it again during the presentation from Professor San Blas from Venezuela. So apologies to her for stealing this slide. But you'll see that the Venezuela crisis has been going on for a number of years, from 2015, Syria since 2012. Afghanistan for a long, long time, you see, 1977, but through different phases. And what is not here on this chart is Yemen, but that's already 10 years since the outbreak of revolution and hostilities in Yemen. So these are really crises with no quick fix. The scientists, the medics, the others that have left the country have no chance of going back still. So they are, still working their way through the different systems of support. And it's the ideas of those stories that we want to get across today, and the different solutions that might be proposed to help those people in that kind of situation. So, as I said, we have five speakers. If we can go to the next slide. We have Zainab Nazari from Afghanistan, and I will give a more detailed introduction in a moment. We have Saja Alzoubi from Syria, currently in the UK, and she is also a member, like Stanley, of our steering committee. Radwan, I don't think, can make it today, so unfortunately, but at least we still have Syria represented. From Venezuela, Joconda San Blas, former president of the Venezuelan Academy, and two speakers from Yemen, Hassan Maridi and Ganya Al-Nakeb. So as I said, we'll move on to the first speaker. We have video recordings, I think, from each of these, but the speakers are present here and ready to get into the discussion and the Q&As afterwards. So Zainab Nazari is a PhD student at Boğaziçi University in Turkey, and also a research fellow here in Trieste in the ICTP, the International Center for Theoretical Physics, in the High Energy Cosmology and Astroparticle Physics section. She was born in Afghanistan, but her family moved to Iran as a refugee when she was just 3 years old. Eventually, and she'll tell her story, she moved to the university in Tehran, and then, like I say, to Trieste and Turkey. So please let us start the video for Zainab's presentation. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Zainab. I was born in a small village in the east part of Afghanistan called Dahmard-e-Gulzar. When I was born, there were no school for girls and boys, just a small religious school to learn how to read and write. In 1995, the first formal school for boys was opened, and 10 years later, girls were also able to go to the school. This is the picture of those early days. After many years, with the help and effort of local people and fund from the people abroad, they built proper schools and are improving them. Here's my journey. When I was 3 years old, my family moved to Iran and applied for asylum. I was raised and educated in Tehran. I was among the first lucky generation of Afghani refugees who were allowed to participate in the university entrance exam in Iran. My wish was to study philosophy in a private school in Tehran. I got admitted there, but due to residency document issue, they have denied to let me enter the school. I was also interested in physics and had an admission in a public university, so I tried my chance there. Fortunately, they accepted my documents and I was registered as a physics student. However, towards the end of my study, they made a new regulation that despite the fact that I was admitted in a public school, as an Afghani student, I have to pay a huge tuition fee to continue. At that time, I decided to think about going abroad, where I can have a fund for my study. With very much luck, I found an advertisement of ICTP diploma program, and I applied there. I was very lucky to be registered as the first Afghani student who admitted to this program. This program was initiated in 1991 by Abdus Salam, the Pakistani Nobel laureate. Diploma was 1 year of intensive program in high energy physics taught by brilliant professors and expertise in the field. I graduated in 2014. At that time, I had no PhD position, and I realized I also have no place to go. Iran canceled all my documents, and I only left with my Afghani passport. ICTP kindly realized and renewed my extension, and I was able to do entrance exam and admitted to a PhD program in Boğaziçi University in Turkey in 2015. In 2018, I came back to ICTP to join a joint PhD program called STEP. It was in 2019 I met Kate Shaw, one of the coordinators of Physics Without Frontier. And we decided to organize a workshop in Kabul University and teach basics of experimental and theoretical concepts in high energy physics. Despite the warning of UNESCO due to the recent explosion in the camp that we were about to go, we hoped for the best and went to Kabul. I was accompanied by Fawad Hassan, an Afghanian professor currently in Stockholm University who left the country 30 years ago, and Marco Celoria, a postdoc in high energy physics, and with the help of local organizer Baktash Amini. It has been a wonderful workshop, and we made a lot of connection and had very interesting discussion with the students and professors there. Here's the summary of some of my thoughts. Despite the war, people are full of hope for progress, and we should be hopeful too. I learned that there are many potential and bright students who are interested to continue their study, and we need to reach them. Scientists fled and they're disconnected around the world. I learned that there are many instability of training due to time explosion and attacks in the country. If the students go to the school, they're not quite sure if they can come back alive to their families again and vice versa. I learned that the department and university in general have few facilities in sense of lab and expertise in the field. For example, they might have only one professor who can teach them quantum mechanics in the entire school. Most of the professors have only master. The quality of education needs to be improved a lot. Sadly, I learned that coming back to the country at the current situation is rather impossible for me and many other scientists around the world. I think what we can do today is to recognize and connect the displaced scientists around the world, connect them together, and connect them to the people in their countries. I think it's important to support the current scientists for higher education and research. They have struggled and are struggling a lot to be where they are today. When COVID-19 happened, I was reminded of the students who are stuck in their home back in Afghanistan due to explosion and war, not the virus, for many years. And I learned how online training could still help people around the world to stay connected, teach, learn, and improve. I think it is very important to strengthen online training in the countries like Afghanistan. Last but not least, I noticed how a local funding in my small village changed the entire face of education today. And I believe if there would be a strong international organization to raise funds for the countries like Afghanistan, which are suffering from the lack of support and scientists, we can change the face of current situation in years to come. Thank you, and let's work and hope for a brighter future of humanity together.
Okay, thank you very much, Zainab, for that informative story of your sequence, your journey from your primary school to your PhD studies. Very interesting, and of course we'll come back to you in the discussions. Next we'll have Saja Alzoubi. As I said, she's also a member of the steering committee of our Science in Exile initiative. She is originally from Syria, a development economist, currently based at the University of Oxford and a visiting scholar at Glasgow University. And she does a lot of work on food security and women-headed households, also with refugees and other sort of affected people. Saja, I hope your video is ready to start, and let's view that.
Everyone, this is Saja. I'm a Syrian displaced scholar and a mother, and I want to share my perspective on supporting displaced scholars with you today through my experience as an academic in conflict time and in exile as well. So actually, my decision to leave Syria temporarily to keep working on science development was made when I had won a fellowship with a prestigious university in USA. But life changes and more sanctions have been raised against Syrians' travel, so I have canceled it. Later, I had succeeded to get trust support to conduct a research about Syrian refugees in Lebanon, and this was my departure point of being in exile, which have ended up in the UK. Actually, the higher education and scientific environment in Syria during the war has been characterized by infrastructure devastation and facilities destruction. So some universities like Idlib in the northern western and Al-Furat in the northeastern of Syria were closed for years. Fund shortage due to the national and international policies and politics and corruption. Science development and international exchange stagnation, especially with the North, lack of research quality and quantity due to the lack of labs, lack of safety to conduct research, especially in rural areas, and the human capital fragmentation and displacement. And here, when we talk in Syria, we are talking about more than 13 million displaced persons in and out of Syria. So actually, as a result of war repercussion, including lack of safety and security, forced conscription of males into the army, and the poor scientific environment, many scientists had to secure a new placement abroad. Meanwhile, based on personal interviews I have conducted with scholars in exile, many Syrians are looking forward to rebuilding science in Syria when it's safe to go back. However, due to the political updates and veteran politicians' declarations, home back will not be on the short and midterm, I'm afraid. So let's now go through these transitional sources journey in the exile. So when we talk about science and scientists in exile, so we mean at risk displaced and refugee scholars, others. Others, the challenges are associated by their characteristics, including gender and marital status, the host country policies and politics, the host institution, and the sponsor, the incubating program. So, yet there's a huge differentiation in the challenges between scientists who have reached the new host country through a sponsor and who have reached it without incubation program, for example, death boats. Hence, outreach programs play a distinguished role to protect these brands, although the lack of fund sources. So, now, how to preserve fragmented and displaced brains? In a total, first, enhancing the programs and organizations that link these brains with prestigious universities and research centers by sources and resources to achieve their vital roles, debilitizing altruists from the international political measures, especially sanctions and bans, maintaining and developing altruist capacities, and restoring others' mental health. So actually, these scholars really miss the feeling of getting settled down into in a safe place with a proper job and full human rights. And as they can't go back home in the soon future, so they can get the stability through a twofold fellowship with 5 years at a minimum in the same host country. So the first 2 years could be as an induction into the new academic environment, new country, new language, new culture, new communities, and the job market demands. And the rest of the fellowship is determined by the scholar interest and the ability of the potential host institution. Then the scholars will be ready to compete in the job market and secure a proper permanent job, and they might find it in another country. But this fellowship period should be dominated by capacity building, mentoring and monitoring scheme, especially with a relative and enthusiastic mentor, evaluation, promotion, access to research funds. This is very important, and to journals, libraries, and work facilities, social fare. So I don't mean here a treasure, but giving a hand to get integrated socially into the new community, and preparation for job market. So again, how to preserve fragmented and displaced brains through raising the awareness of others' role in creating and adding value to international science and development, raising the awareness of these programs' role in supporting science, creating open innovation, rebuilding destroyed countries, and peace building, popularizing these programs via new channels, for example, utilizing success stories in social media, establishing network with the host country's authorities, especially immigration authorities and stakeholders, embracing a flexible structure by embedding an innovative work team, guiding and building others' capacities during the preparation process, targeting and incubating displaced fragmented scholars who are based in both developing and developed countries, creating channels to support and affected scholars in their home also through online programs. And thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Saja. And again, it's interesting points that you raise on things like incubation programs, settlement periods, mentoring, basically getting people sort of into the job market in the countries where they are arriving. And of course, our third webinar in this series will focus a little bit more on that, but I think you've set the transition period for us is very well. So thank you. Let us move on to our third example country, Venezuela. So let me introduce Professor Joconda San Blas. She's a fellow and former president of the Venezuelan Academy of Physical, Mathematical, and Natural Sciences. Her research focuses on medical mycology, molecular mechanisms, and pathogenicity. But she's also a member of citizens groups involved in human rights and the return of democracy in Venezuela. So, Professor Joconda San Blas, I hope your video is ready to go. Thank you for sharing it with us.
Thank you very much to Peter McGraw and IAP to us for the kind invitation to join this webinar. Since early 2000s, particularly from 2013 onwards, and mainly because ideologically inspired political decisions, Venezuela has spiraled down, its GDP fallen by 35%. Nowadays, Venezuela suffers the highest rate of hyperinflation in the world, After reaching a peak of 130,000% in 2019, it has lowered to 2,300% in 2020, still being the highest in the world, followed by Zimbabwe and Sudan, with rates five times smaller. As a consequence, the national currency has become worthless. One American dollar equivalent to more than 4 million sovereigns bolivars. This translates into a worthless minimum wage equivalent to 1.9 American dollars per month, an amount 30 times less than the minimum wage established internationally to qualify as extreme poverty. Salaries for highly qualified individuals and academics are based on these ridiculous scales. As an example, my monthly salary as emeritus researcher goes around $30 per month or less. Hence, the Venezuelan population has sunk into poverty. Field studies indicating that so far around 80% live below the limit of extreme poverty, leading to a complex humanitarian emergency so recognized by international organizations. Under these extremely difficult situations, it is easy to explain why Venezuelans are leaving the country en masse, first time in our history. Throughout the 20th century, Venezuela was a rather prosperous country, massively receiving Europeans and Latin Americans running away from wars, dictatorships, and poverty. No longer. Now the Venezuelan economic collapse is the main driving force for displacement, to which a failed democracy, political persecution, break of law and order, and lack of public safety add to the numbers. Currently, an estimated 5.6 million Venezuelans, around 20% of the population, have left Venezuela, mainly to Colombia, the United States, Spain, and other Latin American countries. Initially, from 2013 to around 2015, the majority, more than 80%, according to sources, were highly qualified individuals who settled in hosting countries, in universities, institutions, and ventures that valued their knowledge. Later, less qualified people started to leave the country to evade harsh conditions of Venezuelan life. It is estimated that about 12,000 scientists and technologists, 30,000 medical doctors, and 50,000 engineers and architects have flown the country. This massive exodus has become the most numerous in current times around the world. Should the flow continue as now, by 2023, there will be no less than 10 million Venezuelans living abroad. Around 88% college students express their willingness to live abroad once graduated. Approximately 50% of academic staff from Venezuelan universities and 30% of the country researchers have left. Because of it and budget constraints, 77% of the country's laboratories have been paralyzed or abandoned. Under these circumstances, there is little wonder that the country's scientific performance, measured as publication rates, has fallen dramatically. According to the Academic Freedom Index, Venezuela scored 0.28 out of 1, placing it well below the average for countries in Latin America and the Caribbean, 0.77. Scholars at Risk, an international network of higher education institutions dedicated to protecting threatened scholars and promoting academic freedom worldwide, submitted a document to the United Nations Human Rights Council in which they document Venezuela's lack of compliance with its obligations under international law to protect and promote academic freedom within its territory, including severe encroachments of university autonomy, targeting professors and students with arbitrary detention, arrest and violence, and depleting autonomous universities from resources to the point of severe dysfunction, the latter exacerbated by a decade-long economic and humanitarian crisis already described. 2 days ago, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, an autonomous judicial institution of the Organization of American States and the Federation of Venezuelan Associations of University Scholars, made pronouncement along this same line. All of them coincide on measures to be taken. Briefly, refrain from engaging in arrest, prosecution, or violence intended to prevent or retaliate for the nonviolent exercise of the right to academic freedom. Ensure adequate funding of all public universities. Release and reverse all charges against student protesters and scholars currently in prison or facing imprisonment for reasons related to academic freedom. Ensure university autonomy consistent with international human rights standards and Venezuela's constitution. This point is particularly pressing since a new project of law of universities currently under discussion in the National Assembly means the abdication of free exchange of ideas and autonomy. Although more than 80% of migrants say they would not resettle into their homeland, even in the event of a change of government, a high proportion of them have established links with Venezuelans within the country or are willing to do it to help in the reconstruction when political changes occur or earlier. Hopefully, with their help and those of international organizations, and mainly with the driving force of Venezuelans within, we will look forward to a brighter future for all. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Gioconda. And of course, this is a very different situation with the economic collapse rather than the sort of the war and aggression that we've seen from Afghanistan and Syria, but no more serious for the people on the ground who are being sort of forced into poverty and the scientists being forced to leave. And interesting to note that you say a lot of people are saying they would not go back, but of course they're willing to help in the reconstruction. And we'll be looking in our fourth webinar in this series on sort of those reconstruction and rebuilding efforts. So again, it's nice that you're building those links for us. Of course, we'll come back to you with some questions and things in the discussion session. So for the moment, again, let us move on to our fourth speaker, and we move to Yemen in this case. And let me introduce Hassan Maridi. He is from Yemen. He's a nuclear theoretical physicist who works permanently at Taiz University in Yemen. He got his PhD from Cairo University, but was forced to leave Yemen in August 2018 when he got a Scholar Rescue Fund fellowship. I'm sure he's going to tell us about that now in the video that he has prepared. So please, can we have Hassan Maridi's video?
I will talk about the situation of Yemeni scholars' displacement. In 2011, the revolution in Yemen ended with the change of authority, and various parties began a comprehensive dialogue, but the Houthis took the capital Sana'a in September 2014, forcing Handi into exile abroad. In March 2015, the Arab coalition led by Saudi Arabia and United Emirates began the airstrikes, and this war and conflict is continuing in Yemen between the different parties: Sana'a authorities, Southern Transitional Council, and the recognized Yemeni government left one of the largest humanitarian disasters in the world, with more than 100,000 dead and wounded and 4 million displaced, and about 80% need urgent life-saving assistance. And the higher education institutions affected by this war resulted in destruction of classrooms. Many scholars and minds migrated. Armed groups have universities for military purposes. Some universities have closed for years. Violent attack, detentions, disappearances, some bombing took place. A number of assassination attempts on university cadres. Many scholars were dismissed. A lot of teachers died due to starvation and disease. The last one is COVID-19. Also, academics in northern universities doesn't get salaries from Sana'a or from Aden. And the closure of Sana'a airport and other airports and cruising points make the traveling and movement of academics and students be very difficult. Also, the academics, those who receive monthly payments from Bank of Aden, are unable to live well. So they are working in other low-paid sectors, like these scholars in these photos. I got a PhD in theoretical nuclear physics from Cairo University, Egypt, in November 2014, returned to Yemen. The war was started. I am working in Taiz University, which was closed and teaching was suspended for more than 2 years. My salary was stopped. My dreams reduced to a single goal, which is to provide a living for my family. I found a teaching work by about $100 monthly for 2 years in Hodeidah University. But you can imagine going to university 60 kilometers away from the home without breakfast and don't having a bus fare to stand talking for 6 hours without eating. Also, me and my family lived in a single room without beds, water, or electricity supplies. I was moving to Sana'a in September 2017 and worked in many private universities. And we suffered because there are no good internet, no electricity, no cooking gas, and so on. And I sell my computer to buy food my family. In mid-2018, I applied to the Scholar Rescue Fund Fellowship from the Institute of the International Education, and I was awarded quickly. I traveled to Aden and then to Amman to join Philadelphia University in Jordan. My family joined me later. This award helped me very much to move to a safe place and to return to scientific research and taught, organized workshop, and so on. Returning to the scientific research and publication made me to get a research scholarship at HVIU laboratory at the University of Warsaw, Poland, for 2 years, ended in mid-2022. This scholarship from the Polish National Agency for Academic Exchange, NAVA, give me the chance to continue my research, to learn more, and to contact with many research laboratories in the world. What the efforts are being made by ours in exile, we always talk with each other, we're sending to each other the opportunities and scholarship, we're sending to other our colleagues in Yemen, we write recommendation letters for them, we provide them advice and assistance as possible. Recently, we construct the Association of Yemeni Academics and Professionals, AYAB, to create a collaborative network of Yemeni academics and professionals. Our goals are in the list. We organized about 14 webinars in Yemeni issues. I was the moderator for two of them, one about the solar, the solar energy, and the other about the wind energy in Yemen. Status and the future. About the plan to return, most researchers want to return, but the continuation of the war prevents this. We hope the rescue grants to continue and increase for Yemeni scientists and graduate students also. For long-term recommendations, firstly, extending the grant period to at least 3 years instead of 1 year, because the time goes to visa and residency matters. Also, there are no consulates in our country, so we hope to take this into consideration when we submit the visa application. And we all suffer from this point. We also hope that obtaining a residency in the host countries be faster, and also taking into account our families in terms of visa and residency matters, and also family reunification. And thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Hassan. And again, some interesting points. You're a great example of the work that is done by the IIE Scholar Rescue Fund. So with your new position in Poland, I think it was. Interesting to note that others like you are still trying to live and work in difficult situations in Yemen. It's this ongoing crisis, but there are opportunities that you are sharing with this IAP, Association of Yemeni Academics and Professionals, to sort of spread the word. So that's an interesting concept that may be replicated elsewhere. And again, interesting to note that many of you, the scientists that have left the country, are keen to return when it is safe and practical to do so. I think we have a question on that in the Q&A that we'll come back to later. So let's crack on with our final speaker of this session, Dania Al-Nakeb, also from Yemen. She's a research fellowship holder at the Center of Agriculture, Food and Environment at the University of Trento here in Italy since August last year, so nearly a year now. From December 2017 to 2019, she was a researcher in the Food Chemistry Institute of Pharmacy and Food Chemistry in Würzburg, Germany. She's also an associate professor of nutritional sciences at the Faculty of Agriculture at the University of Sana'a in Yemen. So let us please show the video from Ganya. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And now I'm going to start my presentation. So when we talk about the crisis in Yemen, there was two crises. The first crisis was started in 2011 because of the inside conflict until it lasted until 2014. And this first crisis led to the second crisis, which started from 2014 until today. And this crisis was because of the war, the inside conflict and the outside war make the situation in Yemen is very difficult. Everything has been damaged and destroyed by this war and conflict, the human being, the infrastructure, and almost all the sectors. Higher education sector was the most effective sectors among all the things in Yemen because of the war and the conflict. And just in Sana'a University, we have 215 academic staff. They were dismissed from their position. And I am one of those dismissed academic. I lost my academic position in 2017. And because of the war and the inside conflict, I also lost my academic position. Besides also my student, they were displaced to another places. And also my samples and my lab also because of the bomb. So in 2017, the situation getting very more worse. And I was actually an associated professor in Sana'a University. I work since 2011 until 2017. While the situation in Yemen was not really good, but I could do many things in this situation. I was involving in teaching, academic teaching, also doing research and representing Sana'a University and my faculty and Yemen also locally and internationally through the Fulbright Scholar to US in 2014 and also a Sapir Foundation Award in 2016. Beside my work as an academic, as a researcher, I was also involved in few projects that mainly focus in the development of rural areas and nutrition awareness for men and women for almost all the villages in elephant governorates in Yemen. In 2017, after I lost my academic position, the situation was very difficult. So in that moment, I started to search about new place to be able to continue my scientific life and also my doing my research. And thank you for TUAS. They could link me to a professor in Germany who who helped me in getting the Philip Schwartz initiative in Germany from December 2017 until November 2019. And I had a good experience in Germany by doing research and not work also, and attending several, delivering talk about Yemen and also attending workshop and conferences. But in 2019, the end of 2019, my fellowship had been finished. So I was struggling again, and I back again to Yemen. And also, thank you again for TUAS. They linked me again to the University of Trento in Italy. And I applied for a position in University of Trento in Italy as a scholar at risk in the University of Trento. And I got it. And since August 2020, I am now in Trento in Italy, and I'm doing my work and in three different departments in Italy. And I like actually the way that the research has been shaped with many collaboration departments. So my career was developed and I could be able to know more scientists in my field. So for the recommendation for long-term strategies, I think extending the fellowship from 2 years until from not only 2 years or 3 years, it will be great if it is 3 or 4 years. Because if we have like 3 to 4 years, the scholar can be able to adapt to the new situation and understand the system, how it goes in the host institution. I see that having in my mind my experience in University of Trento, when the first year is finished, they could manage to extend it another 2 years, which is a very good opportunity for me. Also, giving the displaced scientists more attention since they have wide experience in academia and also administration of scientific facilities and also in the field work. They can really contribute in serving the hosting country in different fields based on their experience. There is also a need for third-party organization that really can support the displaced scientists when their fellowship are finishing, since most of the scholars or displaced scientists, they have some difficulties and challenges to go back to their country. So if the fellowship is finished, it will be very difficult. In that moment, we really need a help or a hand to help us in that in getting maybe another opportunity or maybe extending the visa or something like it, to make us able to stay in the hosting country. For what a scholar need, okay, I will point here about the scientific issue. We need a host institution that can provide a scientific environment, facilities to develop our career, to be able to produce a good research. We also need to be involved in seminars, in also academic seminars, in a discussion and collaboration work, so we can have more network connection and we can have more opportunity to get extension or maybe get a new opportunity. Also, scholars can be engaged, or it will be good if they can be engaged in different activities in the host institution. Beside our practical life, we need also our social life. So I think community outreach is very important in the new country. Scholars need to have a community engagement and outreach. This is also very important for scholars, so we can represent our country, we can be as an ambassador to our countries. We can show them our traditional, our culture, we our food. This is very good, and that may make us feeling that we are a part of this community or new community. So scholars also need to work hard and show their abilities as a good scientist, since there is a big competition in the scientific achievements, especially in the type of the papers and also the grant. So we have to show that we are good enough. Because if we are not producing scientific publication, it will be very difficult for us to have extension or to have any opportunity. I want to point about the postgraduate student, this group of scholars. Not many organizations, they are really pay attention for them. So I think it will be good if we highlight this group of students. I mean, I took this one because I have students in Yemen. Since 2015, they could not finish their master and PhD. So I just have in mind the this year, the University of Trento, they have a PhD position, for candidates who are in the conflict or war area, which is very good. And I hope also many universities can take this action so they can, I mean, it will be helpful for the postgraduate student. At the end, I'd like to answer the question about return back to Yemen. Of course, if the situation in Yemen is safe and stable, I would like to go back to my country for sure, because I would like to contribute to rebuilding New Yemen, especially in the area of scientific research and design the scientific institution. With the gained experience from exile and the network connection, I am really dreaming by that moment, and I hope that moment will be coming soon. And at the end, thank you very much for your attention, and I'm ready to answer any question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ganya, also for sharing your journey. You mentioned Philip Schwartz, of course, and the Scholar Rescue Fund, obviously, and other examples of organizations that are there to help. But you also touched on the idea of the length of the fellowships that you're offered and how much more convenient and helping you settle they would be if they were longer. And I think Saja also touched on that. So that completes our series of presentations. We did share some potential questions with the speakers earlier today, and I wonder if they've had a chance to look at those. And I think we'll try and alternate sort of between those prepared questions and some of those that are coming through in the Q&A, so that we also try and respond to the questions that are coming through from those that are participants. And perhaps I can start with one of those. It's a direct question from Kate Shaw, who I think is here at ICTB in Trieste, to Zainab, asking about the situation with the internet connection in different areas of Afghanistan, and what have been any successes for online training and so on.
Thank you, Kate, for the question. Actually, as far as I know, the connection in Afghanistan is quite poor, particularly for like atypical students, unless they go to school and they can have a better connection. So I think so far there was no any procedure or any plan for like working on connecting people, scholars from abroad to the country and to the students to be able to continue their education, unfortunately.
While you have your microphone, there's another question from Parviz Mosamin asking you about your future plans, if you're planning to return to Afghanistan and start teaching or anything specific. Have you thought that far ahead yet?
Since I haven't lived in Afghanistan, I was 3 years old, I moved to Iran. I think it's quite difficult for me to adapt to the country, but I am always willing and looking forward to teach part-time or online to the students in my country. And about the coming back to Afghanistan, I don't think in the near future I have any clear plan of it.
Okay, thank you. Perhaps I can bring in a couple more of our panelists now. Was it from Yemen mentioned the Association of Yemeni Academics and Professionals, so it could be interesting to hear from Hassan Maridi on this one. How are scientists from your country continuing to engage and network with one another while in exile, and even with those at home? Are there any difficulties associated with such engagement? So you gave one example of this IAP network, but perhaps we can also hear from Joconda San Blas about the new Venezuelan networks that are out there. So first, please, Hassan.
Yes, Peter. We always talk with each other. We participate in webinars with each other. We share the opportunities also with each other, and we send these jobs and offers to our colleagues in Yemen. And also we write recommendation letter for them. We support them by advice and as possible. And recently we construct the Association of Yemeni Academics and Professionals, IAP, to create a collaborative network between between us in the exile, And we organized about 14 webinars about Yemeni issues, about, for example, food in Yemen, electricity in Yemen, the economic situation, solar energy in Yemen, and its future, also the wind energy in Yemen, and other issues. And our goal is to exchange the knowledge between us and between us in the abroad and the our colleagues in Yemen. We hope to succeed. And and there are another collaboration between between the scholars in abroad and in Yemen in topics of I mean, in research, some research did on between groups in abroad and in Yemen, especially in the in agriculture and some topics of research. Okay, that's all.
Okay, thank you. So it's the network is a sort of blend, if you like, of information for on opportunities as well as looking forward, yes, to the future of Yemeni science and development. So,
yes.
Professor San Blas, do you have anything from the Venezuelan side?
Yes, actually. Do you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yes, I have two questions in the Q&A list. One of them is from Eulogio Chacon. He asks, how do we survive with $30 a month? Well, we don't. This is the reason why more than 50, perhaps even more than that, are flying the country, because it is impossible to live on $30 a month, obviously. Those who stay in the country like me are just either having another job we get or live on savings from past times. I don't know if that answers the questions or you need any more information.
Sorry, I was muted. I think that's fine for now. Thank you. I see a lot of questions coming in, so I want to keep moving ahead. There's one from Fawad Hassan in the Q&A about young refugees who want to pursue higher education in transit host countries where they live temporarily could face problems simply because of not having the correct official papers, such as in the case of Zainab. Do UNESCO, UNHCR, and TWAS have a possibility of persuading the host countries to facilitate higher education of young refugees living there? Let me try and answer that one by saying the influence that those organizations have is very limited. Everything really depends on the host countries and their national policies. But one of the ideals of this Science in Exile project, this initiative, is to produce a declaration, which will be coming out in the coming months, and really starting to urge countries to take into account the special needs, if you like, of scientists and others in those sort of transit situations. So we hope to raise this issue and to highlight it to sort of push for solutions. But right now, the, as I said, the solutions are very much vary from country to country. With that, let me pick another question, perhaps from our pre-prepared list. Maybe I can put this one to Saja. I don't think we've put one your way yet. How have your needs as a scientist in exile changed over time? And you mentioned your idea of a 2+3-year fellowship. Maybe that's part of the solutions that you could propose. But give us an idea of how you came up with that proposal, please, Saja.
So thank you, Peter. So in terms of your of the question, how their needs. So actually, when I mentioned about gender and marital status of scientists, so they maybe they will get married, maybe they will get will have a family, new baby. So these needs, with the socially needs, it's actually I think it affects their work and their contribution in a huge way. So when we talk about their needs, so when I mentioned about social welfare, for example, and I mentioned about how it's not for treasure, it's just to giving a hand to support these scholars to adapt to the new environment and support their situation when it's updated. So it's a changing all the time. It's a changing. They maybe they need to their interests maybe will be in a different direction when they start. They started with teaching or with research, and then their interest is more in industrial. So so the needs now to this what I have mentioned in the beginning about to prepare them for the job demand, job market demand. So they should be all the time updated, and every time they change their needs changed should be a resolution. So here we talk about let's talk about about their capacities, their capabilities, and their interests, and their social life, and the politics and the policies around them. So maybe the country they live in, they have changed the migration law. So in this case, they will get affected. Their accommodation and their life will get affected in negatively. So for example, for people who live in Denmark, and the migration law became really harsh and not in the favor of let's talk about refugees or who are who are at risk in Denmark. So just to keep updated with the whole circumstances that surround scholars at risk in their new country. So for that, I emphasize more on the solutions, how to protect and save these brains. So Rula, you mentioned, thank you for the question and your comment, and you mentioned how it's the brain drains. Actually, I'm not agree with the concept in this spectrum, in this context. I'm not agree with brain drains. Actually, I fully agreed with protecting these brains from getting drained. So if we keep them in their countries and in the conflict time, so I don't think they can. They will get drained because they will not be get updated, and they will not be surrounded by scientific environment. This is one issue, but I'm fully agree. Yes, it should be programs to support these scholars and to support them to rebuild their science in the country. But here, programs should also, or the institutions should be international institutions work together to rebuild the infrastructure, scientific infrastructure in these countries, and then how to attract and get back these scientists to their home through a collaboration with the authorities in the home itself. So with, to get the permission from the authorities there. So, but I think in this term, security reasons, security and safety reasons, as I mentioned, the social connections should be safety, should be safe and save their the scholars' privacy. So I think here, safety and security reasons play a main role to in this spectrum. And we, when we talk about scholars at risk, so we should try to save their privacy. On the in the meantime, we should try to. Yes, when it's safe enough to get back, when it's safe and proper, it's have the, in the proper time to get back to their country, so they can cope back and will, should be supported by programs, institutions to be there.
Let me stop you there, if I may, Sajid. And just a reminder that our fourth webinar in this series, we'll also be looking at, you know, countries who have rebuilt and how, you know, how they went about it. And we can sort of share some best practices. So hopefully Rula will be able to join us with that one. But let me move on. There's a question, I've lost it now. It's from somebody in Ethiopia, so Abdul Sheko Ahmed. He's asking, he's in like I say, in Ethiopia. First, let me say that in response perhaps to that question, one of our executive committee members, Kebede Segei from IGAD, which is an intergovernmental association for development in the East Africa region, is working with, you know, scholarships and opportunities for refugees and displaced scientists, especially in East Africa and the Horn of Africa region. So that is an opportunity, Ahmed, that you might want to look at. But his question sort of more generally, and maybe either Hassan or Ganya can comment on this, if he's thinking he's in a situation of threat or at risk, what would you recommend him to do? Where do you start? How do you start thinking? Ganya, please go ahead.
Yes, actually, if he is now in Ethiopia, and if the situation, I can say that from advice. Good people, good scientists. We are almost the good people leave Yemen, and who will contribute to rebuild the country? Because now we are in Yemen, and also the postgraduate student, they are stuck in there. They cannot continue their PhD and master study. So the higher education is totally damaged. And if you are really in a risk and you cannot survive there for maybe 1 year and 2 years, yes, of course, I advise you to start searching about what are the organizations that they help scholars at risk. And now they are a lot actually, and the information is very separated in many media. And you can start searching about the good place to be with, I mean, the good host institution that's suitable for your field and your research. Because I know it's not easy for us to be exiled and be connected in a different places that not much to our field, so we cannot produce much and we can stuck, we can have a lot of stress. I just want to say that even though we are in exile, we have a good life, we have salary, we have a good place, but also we are still under big stress because we are thinking about our family in, I mean, the rest of the family in Yemen, like in different areas, and also our country. So I still have this, how to say, unbalance or unclear things about the time. We don't have to think much and then use our time here and to build a good network connection that can they can help us when we go back to Yemen or to our country. So that's my opinion, and thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. We are running out of time, of course. So I would like to start wrapping up. There are two questions that have come through, so I will say them both here, but then ask each of you to pick one of them to give a very short answer. So the first one is, how do your countries of origin value the science community? So either think about an answer to that one, or are the scientists in other countries like yourselves vulnerable to exploitation? So either or, and I'm just going to go across my screen. Jocanda, I can see your hand up is in anyway, so maybe you can have a go at answering either one of those questions or any other quick final comment.
Well, I just raised my hand because there was another question for me from Professor Jose Rafael Lopez, and he asked about how to make Venezuelans stimulated to return to the country. Well, I think that that is difficult because the crisis is going on for 20 years now, so that there is a new the young people who left with their parents are now settled in another countries. However, there is a good news on this. On the bright side, the Venezuelans have been moved to do a lot of engagement of programs of exchange. Tomás Páez, who is a sociologist working on that particularly subject, he says that there are more than 300 works going on between Venezuelans abroad and Venezuelans within the country. So this is something to be praised, and perhaps this will be the way to join in a new Venezuela. As to how the countries, the government praise science, well, our government doesn't. That is the short answer.
Okay, thank you. And maybe we'll come back to your the answer you've just given when we talk in the fourth webinar about the rebuilding and going back. So next on my screen, I have Zaina. If you have a quick answer to one of those two questions or any other final comment.
I just thank you very much. I don't know about like the question that you ask, how the country of host are trying to improve science. I mean, what I've got from the workshop that we had and talking with the people, they are very much struggling and willing to enhance science and scientists. But I think it's not that they can do it within themselves, because science already was like, had a lot of problems, and scientists like diminished a lot for the country because of the war. And if there are few scientists who are abroad, if they are concerning about their countries and improving the science in the country, they can get together and find a way to help growing new scientists. I think that can help to change this situation much better.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Zainab. Sasha, last words, very quick, please, because we're in the last minute or so.
Thank you, Peter. I just want to thank everyone for this webinar. And I think just building these capacities for scholars at risk who are in their home or in exile, this should be international and national collaboration through whole. So many sectors should work on this. It's not so they work on this all over the world for all people who can support or countries which can support, and for the home countries how they can rebuild the science with the support of their scientists. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on quickly to Ganya.
For me, I just want to thank you very much. And I'd like also to highlight the postgraduate student, the master and PhD student, because for Yemenis, it's a bit difficult because, you know, it's the connection of the internet. And also most of the scholarship, they are requiring acceptance letter. And that is the most difficult things. So I would like really you and all maybe the attendance to have this in mind, the scholar at least who are in their countries and they are stucking in their master and PhD student. Thank you very much.
Okay, and I see in the chat and elsewhere there are opportunities and links. The Humboldt Foundation, DAAD, and PAUSE in France was mentioned as well. It's part of TWAS's goal to bring all these opportunities together on its website as well. So there's a place that people can go to. Hassan, last words. And I don't know if Stanley wants to say something after you, but then we would have to close.
Yes, thank you very much for this webinar. And I would like to thank Scholar Rescue Fund, SAR, CARA, TWAS, DAD, and other organizations for their opportunities and their fellowships. But personally, if the war stopped in Yemen, I will come back immediately because I'm so tired from visa and the residency procedures. I must hard work to get another fellowship. You know, I'm working even in the weekend in order to publish more and to get another visa in the end of this year, for example. We are in not a safe situation in exile. You know, we must work hard to prove yourself and to get another opportunities. So we hope the our countries are good to the best, and we return to our countries to rebuild and participate in development. And thank you very much, Peter.
Okay, thank you. And I think that idea of a sort of continued insecurity has been very much addressed by all of you throughout this meeting. I appreciate we're a couple of minutes over time. The participants seem to be mostly staying with us. We'll finish very shortly. Stanley, last words.
Thank you very much, Peter, and thank you to the panel members and all the participants. This was quite insightful and very exciting for us to hear all the work and all the experiences of the panel members. Looking at some data and some statistics from sub-Saharan Africa in 2019, it was recorded that there are over 15 countries that are involved in one kind of conflict, whether it's armed conflict, civil war, and also we have got some issues of economic issues that really make people to find themselves displaced, to be refugees, to be asylum seekers within the continent. And I was glad to hear somebody from Ethiopia asking a question. And I think it's an opportunity for us to learn from each other and be able to, you know, take this matter forward and bring in, you know, practical steps that can be, used in order to address this particular issue. It's a very, very important issue that we need to continue discussing about. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Stanley. So thank you again to all our speakers for sharing your experiences with us. Thank you to our participants. A good number have stayed on till the very end here. Just a reminder, please do check our website, the sort of final notice in the chat there. Gives the link to the page about the Science in Exile initiative. We do have a newsletter you can sign up to. You'll get sort of a monthly update. We won't bombard your inbox, but you will get the updates. You'll get the alerts for the future webinars. Note that the two more in this series on the supporting in the host countries, including mentorship and fellowship programs. That's the next one. It'll take place in September. And then we've mentioned, of course, the best practices of rebuilding. We haven't set a date for that yet, but we will be looking at countries who have gone through the crisis and come out at the other end and have started or to rebuild their science system. So that should be very interesting as well. Okay, I see the link for the newsletter form is in the chat also. So with that, let me thank you all. It's been a very interesting, informative session. I hope maybe we can also try to answer some of the questions that were not answered. Unfortunately, we didn't have the time. We'll see if we can do that for you. And again, a recording of this will be made available